This is the White Coat Investor Podcast, Milestones to Millionaire, celebrating stories of success along the journey to financial freedom. Here is your host, Dr. Jim Dolley.
This is Milestones to Millionaire, podcast number 30, Nurse Practitioner Millionaire. Today's episode is sponsored by Set for Life Insurance, founded by its president, Jamie Fleischner, in 1993 while attending Washington University in St. Louis. Since then, they've helped thousands of physicians and professionals with their term life and disability insurance needs. As independent brokers, they work on your behalf to shop around to find the most suitable products at the most cost-effective rate. Their significant expertise and down-to-earth style help you move through the process smoothly without any pressure. Because of their volume and exceptional reputation and the relationships they've developed over the years, they have access to special services not available elsewhere in the industry, including special discounts, priority underwriting, handling on some occasions, and exceptions in the underwriting process. So if you need term life or disability insurance, visit setforlifeinsurance.com today. It will help you get set for life. Now, we've got a special guest today, not a physician, not a dentist, but a nurse practitioner. Let's bring him on the podcast and talk about his recent financial accomplishment. Our guest today is Stefan. Welcome to the Milestones to Millionaire podcast.
Thanks for having me, Jim. Appreciate being here.
I understand you recently became a millionaire. Congratulations.
I recently became a millionaire twice over.
Awesome.
I'm almost 2 million now.
Cool. Tell us about what you do for a living and how far you are out of your schooling.
Sure. I'm a board certified psychiatric mental health nurse practitioner, 7 years out of training. And I worked as an RN for 3 years prior to that. Two of those years were during my nurse practitioner training.
And what's your approximate net worth right now, you said?
Approximately 2 million.
And what's that divided up into?
Home equity, $469,000, private real estate equity, $100,000, total U.S. stock market, $656,000, total international, $388,000, value, $62,000, small caps, $62,000, small caps value, $54,000, growth, $8,000, a 2045 BlackRock Life Path Index, $88,000, cash, vehicles, and miscellaneous property, $56,000. I max out all of my retirement accounts. I contract an S-Corp. So I have a solo 401k, HSA, and backdoor Roth IRA. My wife has a work 401k with a match and a spousal backdoor Roth IRA. We also have a 529 plans for two kids. Each were front-loaded with $5,000 and $450 per month are put into those. I intend to have a cash balance plan eventually, but I'm currently saving for a larger home. You probably noticed I didn't mention bonds. Holding no bonds is definitely not something I can recommend to others. I have a high risk tolerance, and I verified that that I have a high risk tolerance during the last bear market, because after it had dropped about 30%, I was fine. And I asked myself, how would I feel if it dropped another 20%? And I was still comfortable. This is because I've educated myself about market history. If I had to wait 10 years for my portfolio to recover, I'm going to be fine. However, I would not want others to assume that they would be just fine. So I recommend that they hold a portion of their portfolio in bonds, actually.
So pretty standard investments, aggressive, but pretty typical investments, a bunch of index funds, a little bit of real estate, your home equity, and only 7 years out of training, which is the impressive thing. People are going to go, wait a minute, I thought he said he was a nurse practitioner 7 years out of training. How in the world does he have $2 million? So let's ask the follow-up question, which is, what's been your range of income throughout your career?
So as a psych RN in 2011, I was making about $24 as a W-2 employee in upstate New York. In 2013, making $48 per hour as an RN as a per diem 1099 in the LA area. By 2015, as an outpatient psych NP, I was making around $280K per year, working 50-hour weeks. In 2017, I started working as a contractor for a prison. By 2019, working 50 hours per week, I was making around $325,000 in 2019. And finally, $408,000 in 2020, working 60-hour weeks in the prison. And I've since cut that down to 50 hours per week.
That's a pretty solid income for a nurse practitioner. That's probably 4X the nurse practitioner average. Now, I've always been thoroughly impressed more by the range of income in a given profession or a given specialty than I am the average income between specialties. The intra-specialty differences always seem to be greater than the inter-specialty differences, but that's still a pretty impressive income given your training. What did you do in your career? It sounds like, I mean, we can read between the lines a little bit that you decided to work pretty hard and also were willing to maybe take some jobs that maybe weren't as desirable as others. But what would you say was the secret to success as far as getting such a high income in your career?
Sure. And I have a fairly long list for you, so bear with me on this one, but I think I have a lot of good info for your listeners here. Number one thing was frugality. The saying a penny saved is a penny earned is wrong. When you give regard to taxes, a penny saved is worth two pennies earned. Spend a bit of time to shop for the best deal, and whatever you save is worth double in earnings. So it's a good idea also to marry a frugal spouse. Our savings rate is around 45% of gross. That's including 529 contributions and mortgage principal. We achieved that rate despite living in an $800,000 home in Southern California with two children. About half of that goes into maximizing retirement accounts, and the remainder goes into taxable for now. So I mentioned before that I'm planning on buying a house. So technically, that's not all savings that's going into retirement right now, but eventually it really is going to be about 45% once we buy another home in a couple of years. Number three is do-it-yourself investing. I don't have to pay a financial advisor, and that saves me a ton of money. The problem is, if you don't know what you're doing, it can lose you a ton of money, and people who don't know what they're doing rarely seem to know it. Number four is don't sell in a bear market. Even if you think it will drop more, it probably will leave without you instead while you wonder when to jump back in. Number five, investing, not speculating. I invest in private equity, real estate funds, as you mentioned, and passively managed, broadly diversified mutual funds with low expense ratios. So I'll outperform nearly 90% of investors simply by keeping my costs low in mutual funds. Number six, and this was kind of more alluding to what you're getting at, geographic arbitrage. I focus on earnings potential, and I'm willing to travel for work. I drive 2.5 hours per day, allowing me to listen to financial audiobooks and podcasts along the way. That segues into number seven, read finance books. I've listened to 67 audiobooks, most of them more than once. You can get most of what you need, of course, from reading about 2 to 6 quality books, but I'm a hobbyist. I listen to your WCI book and bootcamp book 3 times each, and your bootcamp was phenomenal for proactive financial structuring. Number eight, participate in finance forums and read finance articles. The WCI forum was a humongous contributor to structuring my financial life in a tax-efficient manner. The quality and sophistication of the free advice there is far superior to anything I've ever paid for. I also participate in the WCI Facebook group regularly. You guys have done some great work cleaning up the nonsense in there, by the way, recently. Understand how compounding works is number nine, and be able to use a compound interest calculator to determine real inflation adjusted returns or costs. 10, front loading work hours. I'm opting to work harder while younger in order to front load my financial future, allowing the force of compounding to start working early. Dollars earned early in your career are much more valuable than dollars earned later due to compounding. Through nearly 1 year of the pandemic, I worked 60 hours per week working 10-hour shifts because I was afraid I was going to lose my job potentially. So I made $408,000 in 2020 as a lowly nurse practitioner. In January, I cut down to 50 hours per week plus the 2.5 hours per day of commuting time. I'll cut hours down as I go since compounding has less of an effect on dollars earned later, and I want to enjoy my life. 11, no debt out of school. I graduated with no debt. When applying to nurse practitioner school, I had a choice to go to expensive prestigious schools like NYU or Columbia. I opted for Cal State Long Beach and got my degree for under $25,000. I realized that nobody cares where I went to school. They care that I can prescribe and diagnose. Education is what you make of it anyway. Number 12, eliminating my spouse's debt. When I met my wife, she had $160,000 worth of mostly school debt for her college and physical therapist education. Early in the relationship, I informed my wife, then girlfriend, that if we were to pursue the relationship, we needed a plan to tackle her debt. We refinanced early on with SoFi. My wife worked Saturdays and paid off $160,000 of debt in about 4 years on a physical therapist income of about $100,000. While paying about $3,000 per month towards her debt, she managed to pay off or pay for our groceries and utilities on top of that. Number 13, buy in bulk. I buy in bulk to save money, especially when things are cheap. I keep them in storage. I once purchased $3,000 worth of toys and baby items we needed from Toys R Us going out of business sale. Buying the cheaper price for the items we would have eventually purchased anyway. Every time we need a children's birthday gift, it saves us time, not having to go to the store, and it saves us money and gas not used. My wife would argue that the gas saved via shopping. That the time and gas are saved via online shopping anyway. However, 14, credit card hacking. We don't travel much, so we get cash back, making sure to use cards with the best benefit for a given item. This game only works for us because we're frugal. Studies show that most people spend more using credit cards, and we try to make a conscious effort to assure we only purchase things that we would have purchased anyway. 15, money-saving applications. We use applications like Honey and Capital One Shopping when purchasing online to help us find the best deal. 16, online surveys. I get paid to take surveys online specific to my profession as a side hustle. 17, no new cars. I buy them used and pay cash. They should be fuel efficient. I rarely spend on car washes, and I run cars into the ground. 18, negotiate wages by leveraging multiple job offers against each other. And lastly, 19, budget. Eliminate extraneous costs that you don't really need to make you happier. And I budget with my wife at least once per year.
It's quite a list.
Yeah, I tried to cover everything in a nice, neat package for everybody. So hopefully that works out.
I'm starting to think maybe I should have told you to write a guest blog post instead of coming on the podcast.
Well, I can do that too.
I think hobbyist is a pretty good description of your approach to personal finance. You're clearly into this stuff and you're good at it, and you've been very successful because of that.
Oh yeah, I love it. And I love helping other people do it. It's definitely a hobby that I enjoy, and I enjoy helping other people educate themselves as well.
And what would you say to somebody that wants to do what you did? They're a nurse practitioner out there just coming out of school. And they're not necessarily a hobbyist. They don't live, eat, and breathe this stuff. They're not going to listen to 100 plus books on tape about finance. They're not going to spend any time on forums. What are the things that they most need to do in order to be as successful as you've been?
The big thing has got to be the savings rate more than anything else. And, you know, invest conservatively, broadly diversified mutual funds, and probably some bonds in there. I think that covers the vast majority of it. That list covered a lot of the other additional little bells and whistles.
Awesome. Well, Multimillionaire is a nurse practitioner, just 7 years out of school. It's very impressive, very inspiring. Thank you for coming on the Milestones to Millionaire podcast to share your story.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it.
All right. Well, that was something, wasn't it? Stefan's great. There are a few things you can learn from this episode. One, you know, if you're making $200,000 or $300,000 or $400,000 and you save a whole bunch of it and you invest it smartly, getting that couple million dollars in just a few years is not that hard to do. It can be done. So I think that's lesson number one. Lesson number two is, you don't necessarily have to accept the caps on your income that people think they have, right? There are a lot of people out there, whatever they're doing, maybe they're a dentist and they think they can't make more than $140,000 a year, or they're a pediatrician, they don't think they can make more than $160,000 a year, or a family practice doc that doesn't think they can make more than $220,000 a year. But I'll tell you what, there is no cap. And it is easier to double your income than you might think. I had a long conversation with Stefan after we stopped recording about what he did to get his income up as high as it is. And the bottom line is he kept looking for jobs that paid better. And when he found them, he took them. Even if he had to drive 2.5 hours, even if he had to work in a prison, that's what he did. And if you want to, you know, become financially independent early, you want to have a high income, then that's how you do it. You're willing to move. You're willing to work places that other people aren't willing to work. You're willing to do some geographic arbitrage. And that's how you do it. It really depends on what your priorities are. Now, everyone's not willing to do that. I totally understand that. But it's pretty interesting to see what can happen when you are willing to do that. And then finally, I think the other lesson to learn is just how powerful it can be when personal finance and investing becomes your hobby. Stefan is clearly really into this stuff. I think he's more into it than I am. And you listen to everything he's doing to boost income and increase savings and try to do it all right and build his wealth as quickly as he can. And you know what? It paid a lot of dividends. He's doing great. He's killing it. And, you know, so that's something there that can really be appreciated, that personal finance is the best paying hobby out there. I hope you enjoyed that episode. Today's episode is sponsored by Set for Life Insurance, which was founded by Jamie Fleischner. They've helped thousands of physicians with term life and disability insurance needs. As independent brokers, they work to shop around to find the most suitable products at the most cost-effective rate. Their expertise and down-to-earth style help you move through the process smoothly without any pressure. And because they've been doing this for so long for so many people, they sometimes have access to services not available elsewhere in the industry, like special discounts, priority underwriting handling, and maybe even some exceptions in the underwriting process. So if you need term life or disability insurance, visit setforlifeinsurance.com today. It will help you get set for life. Keep your head up, shoulders back. You've got this and we can help. We'll see you next time on the Milestones to Millionaire podcast.
My dad, your host, Dr. Dahl, is a practicing emergency physician, blogger, author, and podcaster. He is not a licensed accountant, attorney, or financial advisor, so this podcast is for your entertainment and information only and should not be considered official, personalized financial advice.